Okay, so I'm Thomas Castelain, working at the University of Costa Rica. I'm very glad to be here to present, to have the opportunity to share this research with you, which was part of my PhD I defended 7 months ago. And now I'm back to Costa Rica to work at the university. And as you noticed, I'm not Costa Rican, I'm French. That's why, the accent, okay? My accent is better in Spanish, but I have to do the talk in English. I have to deal with my accent, sorry. Okay, so in this flash talk, I would like to present the framework we use in the series of experiments I will present in my poster. So we acquire a large number of our beliefs through communication, and however, we cannot blindly rely on others' testimony. If people have various level of knowledge or expertise, and they rarely have perfectly aligned incentives. As a result, we can expect humans to be endowed with mechanisms of vigilance, epistemic vigilance that filter communicated information so that most beneficial information is accepted and most harmful information is rejected. So some of these mechanisms pay attention to the contents. It is plausible, it is supported by good arguments, and others to the source of information. It is trustworthy, or is she competent? For instance, you would more likely trust your medical doctor talking about a disease than your postman. Besides, when an information is communicated to you, it's also checks again your background of intentions and beliefs. So if you find some incoherence, you may reject the message. Thus, in some cases, the message of the sender is not effectively communicated, and the receiver may miss some valuable information. So, how to transmit a message that will not be accepted on trust? To overcome this limitation, the sender can provide reasons supporting our message, and the receiver can evaluate. Can evaluate the message, okay? And producing and evaluating arguments, sorry for the, okay. Here we go. Okay, so producing and evaluating arguments, it's one of the functions of reasoning according to the argumentative theory of reasoning, which claims that reasoning has a social and more particularly an argumentative function. So one of the functions of reasoning is to produce arguments, to convince others, and to evaluate arguments provided by others to be convinced only when appropriate. So according to this framework, strong enough arguments should be able to overcome a deficit of trust. For example, a sender who is not trust enough, for instance, because she lacks power, but who provide strong arguments should be believed. In order to test this prediction, one can try to determine whether children under the testimony of a subordinate will give strong arguments over that of a dominant will give a weak argument. So recent work showed that Occidental children from an early age identify the dominance from different sources and make inferences based on dominance. Furthermore, Occidental children from 3 years old can also discriminate a weak argument from a strong argument. So children seem to detect and use these two different cues. However, their confrontation had never been studied until the study we've done. And we can wonder if the same results can be observed in different cultural contexts. So indeed, conducting such a test in populations standardly recruited in developmental psychology raised some issues. For example, Western cultures have been described as putting a special emphasis on the use of reason in argumentation and debate. And the specificity of weird cultures is also reflected in parenting style, in particular in middle and upper classes. On the contrary, anthropological sociological and linguistical linguistic data from traditional society suggests that dominance plays an important role, while argumentation, especially the argumentation addressed to children, plays a more modest role. Therefore, children in the traditional culture provide a more robust test for our hypothesis. And Eastern cultures, in this case Japan, represent another interesting point of comparison with weird children. While we can consider that the parenting style is quite similar to weird cultures, the weight of the respect of social harmony can create a context in which argumentation is less valorized, while a hierarchy should play a higher role than in weird cultures. And we will see in the result that it's not what we expected. So I invite you then to see what's happened. So in the first experiment, we test whether children discriminate circular from perceptual arguments and use this cue when they have to evaluate testimony. In a second experiment, we test whether children take dominance into account when evaluating testimony. And finally, we test the confrontation between the source-related cue, dominance, and the content cue type of arguments. So in my poster, I will present empirical evidence gathered in France, Guatemala, and Japan, which help to better understand how the children from different cultures use different cue and how they weight them when in conflict, and how the cultural background can affect the way they interpret this cue. In particular, the research also opened new questions about the development of the argumentative skills, but also what kind of inferences children made based on dominance and when some cross-cultural difference emerge. So to conclude, I would like to thank all the children who participate, the people who helped me to collect the data, and of course my colleague and especially my PhD director, the last one, Hugo Mercier. Okay, thank you for your attention. I'm sorry, I was a little bit late, but they told me 2 hours ago that I had to do a talk today, a flash talk. So I had to do a flash preparation for a flash talk. Okay, so thank you.